Pat Wallach and her daughters came to our gallery hoping to hear from the brother they'd lost to a tragic drug overdose. While they did get the closure they'd hoped for, they also received an unexpected message for another family who'd also lost a son. After months of effort, the two families would connect, an occasion which would happen extraordinarily on the same day we arrived to meet with the Wallach family again.
Thank you so much.
I started calling all the people with the last name that they have in Philadelphia. Well, every other one. And I figured I had to hit somebody that knew. Finally, one of Kathy's relatives called me and asked if Michael would have been 21. And I said, yeah, about that. And she said, I think it's my relative. And this is, you know, his mom's and dad's name and phone number.
When she called me, my knees buckled.
In fact, Kathy called Pat back the exact day we were scheduled for a follow-up interview with the Wallach family.
We were on the phone, and you pulled up, and I said, here, talk to her.
Our crew and the Wallachs headed over to the Staubs, where the families met and then sat down to watch the original read together for the first time.
Somebody back there lost their son or has a younger male who has passed.
Brian was a quiet kid. Actually, he never smiled as a kid. I used to kid with a girlfriend of mine that my child was born depressed, but he was really very loving. Even at 18, when he had a problem, he would cuddle up to me, put his head on my lap, and cry. He started smoking pot and got into the pills. I think what drew him into it, actually, he was a quiet kid. He was shy, and when he did drugs, it made him more talkative, more social, but unfortunately, it takes you under then.
He was just really a beautiful person. When he wasn't doing his things, he was a beautiful person.
I feel bad because that last 4 years of his life, people only saw the drug addict, the criminal, and they didn't see the person that was hidden in there. Brian turned 18 the 4th of October, and he died the 29th of October.
I need to acknowledge the connections coming up with Diane or Diane as well.
Diane's my niece. And she was the first person I called after the reading. And she's like, Aunt Patty, shut up, you're lying. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And she told me about a dream she had. And, well, yeah, you dreamt that you were watching the show because you knew I was going. She said, no, Aunt Patty, you don't understand. Brian kept calling my name. That was what I dreamt.
Somebody was known by their last name or a version of it.
My brother was known by his last name.
Where it would be written out somewhere where you could see it,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. He graffitied my whole room.
Brian was a graffiti person, and he did his whole room in graffiti.
There's a three connection that he wants me to acknowledge, and I also feel like I need to acknowledge that it can be in the month of March. There's like a three connection. Do you understand that?
My birthday.
I was married on March 23rd.
What's March 23rd? That's my birthday.
Are you serious?
That's my birth.
Where's the leukemia? Who had like?
I had a friend who had leukemia.
Passed from that?
Yeah.
Okay. Your brother who's passed is telling me to acknowledge the leukemia passing as well. And Michael is where?
Michael's the one with leukemia.
Michael's one of a kind. He was very. I feel fortunate to have him as a son.
Michael had an aura about him that drew everybody to him. Michael was everything to me. He was my heart. He was my soul. He was my baby. He was my third.
As the oldest, you know, the younger siblings are always supposed to look at you as a good example. But in reality, he showed more courage than any one person I have ever seen in my life and probably ever will see.
He was diagnosed in April at the age of 20, and it was a very rare form of leukemia. I think one of the fondest memories I have is on a New Year's Eve. He had his 21st birthday party here. He didn't want to have it in a hall, he wanted it here. And there was so many people that came that we had to take the cake outside at midnight. And the street was unbelievably packed.
They were crying because they knew that he wouldn't be here much longer. But he would console them and say, it's all right, I'm okay.
He was, and forever will be, my hero in life.
I was just shocked. I was like, why would he come through me? And then when I was watching it and the whole last name thing and how there has to be a connection, how John connects him through.
It's gotta be the name. There's gotta be, or it's gotta be the whole last name, first name reference.
I always thought my brother, Wallachshaw, and then I'm like, Stalby. Because I never called him Michael. I always called him Stalby. I was like, huh.
All his friends called him Stalby.
Yeah, it's never Michael.
So the two of them, Brian and
Michael.
Yeah. That used the last name because none of Brian's friends called him Brian.
After he passed, did they project his image someplace?
Yeah. For like a lot of people to see. Wait a minute. Just imagine sitting like at, I don't know, in bleachers or like at a stadium somewhere.
Right in front of bleachers.
And then watching.
This picture's right in front of bleachers.
It was at this point that the Staub family realized that this was a validation for them.
The picture, and with the stands. The picture really makes me think about it. Because everything just falls into place with the picture.
Just imagine sitting at like a stadium, and then like looking up at the television and then seeing an image that would be of your son. It's like something's being projected of him outside or up somewhere. I'm saying sporting related only because of what I'm being shown.
Okay.
Like I'm sitting up like a stadium up on bleachers where people can view something. It's as if somebody might have been an artist and actually painted him or drew him outside where it's projected, where you can like see it.
Two families were connected by sons who, even though they'd never met, came through together in our gallery. Now Michael's family shares a staggering validation.
After he passed, did they project his image someplace?
Yeah, for like a lot of people to see? Wait a minute, just imagine sitting like at, I don't know, in bleachers or like at a stadium somewhere.
Right in front of bleachers.
And then watching
this picture's right in front of bleachers. A baseball field that he used to play at, he played up there almost all 14 years. And actually his last game that he won a city championship at that field, he pitched.
I'm gonna say it's sporting related only. Wait, I'm saying sporting related only because of what I'm being shown.
Okay.
Like I'm sitting up like a stadium up on bleachers where people can view something.
And right behind those bleachers is a wall and they're putting a mural of his picture on that wall.
It's as if somebody might have been an artist and actually painted him or drew him outside where it's projected, where you can like see it.
It's as you're walking across, it's like, there's Michael. It's a beautiful picture. It looks just like Michael when he was about 13.
There's some type of acknowledgement of like a photo that's used, but the photo that's used doesn't apply.
I always had a picture up on my mirror of him when he was younger, but it was my favorite. He was in purple, his favorite color, purple. So when they called, I went to walk upstairs. Well, the picture wasn't there. I don't know where it went. I could not find the picture that I wanted, and that was my second choice.
As the read continued, the similarities between two young men and their families, who had so little in common in life, became clearer.
Do you guys work together in family counseling, or have you guys gone to family counseling?
I am a counselor.
Oh, you're the counselor?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
I work with her.
And she works with me now.
Brian was a drug addict, and I'm a drug and alcohol counselor.
Michael's passing also influenced his mom's career.
He's telling me to talk about the book that you're writing or the journal that you write in or seeing your words that you don't talk but you write.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to know he gets what it is that you're projecting out.
He said to me that he was going to be a nurse, and I said, oh, okay. I said, well, if you're going to be a nurse, I'm going to be a nurse. He said, okay, remember you said that. Well, when he came home, I had to run his IVs, give him needles, do everything. And he said to me one day, don't forget your promise. He said, because you're going to be somebody else's nurse. And I was like, no, Mike. He said, no, promise me. And I said, I promise. Right now I'm in college. I'm going to be an oncology nurse. And it's all due to Michael. It was a promise we made to each other. Every time I open my books, I think of Michael.
Thank you very, very much.
Okay, thank you.
This is the biggest gift I could have. Knowing that he's all right.
I'd left there feeling really at peace, and my beliefs were kind of validated. I do believe that once you're out of a body, that's when you are really free, and you're with the people you love 24/7. And I always did say that I would have loved for my son to have found peace here with me. But if that wasn't possible, I just hope that he finally has it. And I got that message. I feel that the family's kind of connected now. You know, that we're special to each other. Our children are sending us, you know, down that path.
They're guiding us.
Yeah, they're our angels, and they're there. And, you know, we just have to listen.
On the count of three, I'd like you to